during my years as a school leader, during my years as head of a large secondary school, in my electorate acting president, I was privy to some behaviour that was absolutely out of order. And it's the type of behaviour that all school leaders experience, a small number of school teachers experience, that is the type of behaviour that the minister tells us he's seeking to target through this bill. So we're speaking about real issues. Here on this side of the house, we don't oppose this bill. We think that in many ways, it will do things that are useful.
I'm sure that many in this chamber would agree by saying that I am disappointed that there's even a need for this legislation at all. Overwhelmingly, parents, carers and other members of our school communities value and respect their children's educators and school staff.
Raising the issue of children emulating adult behaviour is so important to this bill. It raises a very possible unintended consequence of the bill, and that is, when you ban a parent from the school, it may become an excuse for the child to disengage or worse, to not show up. I wonder about the practical implications, such as if a parent has an order taken out against them and their child doesn't turn up. Is the parent notified? And if so, how?
Hopefully, when people are making that decision about will I go into an educational career, they can say, well, this bill helps to ensure a greater level of safety of recalcitrant and dangerous parents or guardians or school sort of associates related to children.
A couple of years ago, there were extensive headlines about violence in schools. Over 1,600 incidents of minor assaults or aggressive behaviour were reported in schools across Victoria in a year. In the same year, there were over 230 major incidents. These included a case where someone drove a car aggressively towards a teacher. Another, where a principal was threatened with a stick with nails attached. Other incidents where staff members and students were assaulted and threatened with knives, tasers, rocks and hammers. It may be a good start, but more is needed. Schools need more resources, they need more support to be able to deal with these issues that the government has created in the last 12 months.
I think from the outset, I'm greatly troubled by this bill. I think the objectives of the bill are obviously commendable. The process in 2019, where there was a task force that reviewed the issues around violence in schools, seemed to be an excellent process. The recommendations that came out of that task force were excellent, but this does not reflect that. Really, if there are problems like this, we should be dealing with them, we should be de-escalating this, we should not be kicking these parents out of the school family, we should be embracing them, we should be looking at early intervention to do this. That's what I want to see, that's what the task force recommended. That is not what is in this bill.
We know this government loves a law and order approach to solving some problems, and while we support measures to keep teachers safe at school, the Greens are concerned that in practice these reforms potentially create significant police-style powers for teaching staff. The Greens will be moving amendments to introduce additional safeguards into this bill, including reporting measures and stronger internal review provisions, and I'm happy to circulate those amendments now.
The problem, as usual, is that this legislation goes too far. Violence and threats of violence are crimes. These crimes are clearly outlined along with their penalties in the Crimes Act 1958. If there is reluctance to prosecute parents of students under their care, which may well be understandable, there is already the option to apply for an intervention order. It isn't clear why these existing systems are not considered adequate.
Finally, it's important to note that the bill also contemplates and encourages mediation to be engaged in the extent possible after an order has been issued. In particular, the bill allows for authorised persons to revoke an order at any time where the person subject to the order has undertaken certain actions specified in the order, such as engaging in mediation.